Thank you, everyone.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Frontier Tampa Walk. Today, we're going to be taking a look at how early Tampa was a frontier city on the edges of U.S. imperial expansion, and how Tampans over the course of the 19th century tried to shed that rough frontier image. On this walk, it kind of differs from other walks. If you've been on any of our other walks, there aren't a lot of physical remnants left of early Tampa. So as we walk, we're going to have we have a stack of photographs we're going to be showing you as we go, and then we've also distributed a brochure which gives you more photographs, and then there are also ads to give you a little peek back into what early Tampa looked like. So if you didn't get one of those brochures, there should be some on the table. So we're going to split into two groups. I'm going to lead one, and Alina is going to lead one too. So I'm going to go stand here. Alina will stay here. If you want to gather with us, we will then start on our walk.
All right. We're going to start out by walking all the way down Franklin Street. So that's going to be our big walking part of the locomotion. So let's go.
So we gathered next to this marker, which was for a cemetery that was discovered when they were building the parking garage. And there were soldiers and Seminoles buried here from the Second Seminole War.
So here we are at the Fort Brooke Cemetery. And what we're going to talk about here is how Fort Brooke was the center of white, black, Native American relations in West Central Florida during the early to mid 1800s. It was essentially the first incarnation of downtown Tampa. Now, Fort Brooke was founded in 1824, which was 21 years before Florida became a state and 31 years before the city became incorporated. It had been founded in order to monitor runaway slaves who had escaped into then Spanish-owned Florida and joined up with the Seminoles.
This, in the end, played a role in the First Seminole War. So the U.S., after the First Seminole War, had a real interest in kind of controlling Florida so that this kind of activity didn't happen again. So in 1819, they took possession of Florida from Spain, and then it was 5 years later that the fort was founded. So when we think of forts, we typically think of walled fortifications, but that's not how Fort Brooke was.
Fort Brooke was very different. A girl writing in 1842 who was staying there said that it was a collection of 20 or so whitewashed houses, which means that they were painted white, and that it created a very neat appearance. Going with this neat appearance, the fort's namesake, Colonel Brooke, had made special sure that the oaks around Fort Brooke stayed there because he liked them. He thought they were pretty, and it built a nice aesthetic for the fort.
So if you take a look at, we're passing around an engraving and a photograph, you can kind of get a glimpse of what the landscape looked like. And the engraving, you'll notice that there is a very diverse mix of people in that landscape. There's white soldiers, African Americans, and Seminoles all gathered together at the fort. And this really represents how people at the time viewed the fort, because it was a meeting ground for all these different types of people. Seminoles would come to the fort for trading, and they would often stay overnight.
It was so diverse that one soldier who was stationed there wrote that the best way to communicate with all these people was through pantomime. It became a meeting place for both commerce, as you had goods coming in from all those roads in your pamphlets, as well as war during the Seminole Wars, as well as the Civil War.
So both trade and military action brought people to the fort. It was a place of gatherings. You'll notice that there are numerous roads and trails leading into the fort area. And this really made Fort Brooke a hub.
Because there were so many people here, bringing so many different things, the city grew up around it. On what we would now call Whiting Street, there was a post office, a trading post, a bowling alley, an oyster bar, and a billiards hall. All because Fort Brooke became so popular.
So Fort Brooke was really the catalyst for Tampa, the city, existing. We're calling Fort Brooke the original gathering place for the city of Tampa, since it gathered everybody to this location. So our next stop is going to be what was the first paved sidewalk in Tampa, and we're just going to go back up Franklin to the corner of Kennedy.
Does anybody know where that is already?
Okay. So these slabs right here in the wall and then over here on the ground, these are fragments of what was Tampa's first paved sidewalk.
So the first paved sidewalk symbolized early Tampa's desire to modernize itself, to attract a higher class of residents and investors, and to display their throwing away of their frontier image. Now in 1888, Civil City board member and local baker Archibald Ross had these placed in front of his bakery. And what he was doing was he was taking part in this larger effort to modernize and make Tampa look nice.
At the time that these were put in place, most sidewalks in Tampa were made out of wood. That was a really common material for sidewalks around Tampa. Yeah, go ahead and just look at the photo. Some of the sidewalks were actually made out of sawdust and oyster shells. So these are evidence of Tampa's efforts to change their frontier town into a more prosperous and modern city. Tampa's population began to rise in the 1880s, and the city leaders wanted to make sure that this population boom continued. So they started passing a lot of city ordinances to kind of clean up Tampa's image. So they actually did pass ordinances that said that sidewalks on important streets like Franklin and what was Lafayette, now Kennedy, had to be made of durable materials, such as brick, cement, or marble. There were other ordinances that were designed to make the city seem more respectable or civilized at this time.
Other ordinances included, Tampans could no longer dump their dead horse bodies in Hillsborough River. Where are you going to put those? And they also could no longer be naked down by the river. There's no more fun in Tampa. They also could not shoot their guns off in the middle of the streets. And this sort of gives you an idea of what frontier Tampans were doing. And it's a little bizarre. The roads were so sandy, in fact, that journalist Richard Harding Davis, when he came here during the Spanish-American War, called Tampa an ocean of sand. He said that people walked around in sand up to their ankles. And of course, the civic leaders of the city were very upset by this and wanted people to not think that Tampa was sandy and gross and hard to walk in. So what they did was they passed another ordinance that required all the streets to be paved, and that was 1898. And at the time, the Tampa Tribune said that it would make these paved streets would make Tampa the most prosperous city in Florida.
A prosperous city, though, needed more than just paved streets and sidewalks. It needed stable people, stable families to come into it and really settle here. And one of the ways that happened, or one of the ways you knew that was happening, is when women started to settle in these places. Frontier areas were typically settled by men, and women were scarce. So once women really started to appear in the area, and at this time women were considered, or at least middle class and usually white women, were considered caretakers of civilized life in the 19th century. So when women started appearing, that was great for the town. They were really, on their way to being a proper city, they thought. Sidewalks such as these were meant to tame Tampa's sandy streets and clean up its rough image. So our next stop is actually back over at Gaffert Square, where we're going to talk about an opera house that used to be there. This area was actually known as Giddens Corner. It was named for a clothing store that was here, the Henry Giddens Clothing Store. Now, for those of you that already have the photograph, you can see that what was the most different about this block is that there were a lot of buildings here. And that photograph that is making its way around was actually taken from the old courthouse, which was over here. So we're basically standing at where you're looking at. And the building we're going to talk about is
the Branch Opera House. So Tampa's mixed frontier and urbanized identity was reflected in the kind of entertainment establishments found throughout the city in the mid to late 1800s. Now, during the late 1800s, this area was full of shops. We have a picture going around about that.
For over 70 years, at least into the 1950s, it was the core of the city, and shops and businesses that stood here were a really important part of that. You can also look at a photograph in your brochure, the Branch Opera House.
It was opened in 1880. and it held roughly 1,500 people. It was about half the population of Tampa. It was really big. It was a big deal. It was the largest performing arts center in the area, and it featured some national touring shows. But it wasn't just a performing arts center. It was also a place for cultural, social, civic, and political gatherings. The Tampa Business Bureau often met at the Branch Opera House to talk about deals of what investors they wanted to bring in and how are they going to sweeten the deal and things like that. And one of the unique things about opera houses at this time was that they weren't just a place for the elites. It's not the opera in our mind where everyone's stuffy and they have glasses. These are more of ruckus places that included all social classes of people.
Unlike today, when opera tickets or theater tickets seem pricey and maybe a little bit exclusive because of that, in the late 1800s, all kinds of people would have gathered in places like the opera house, and the interactions with the stage performers were often very lively and sometimes rowdy. So it was very different back then.
If you could imagine a little bit less than a rock concert. Everyone was talking, they talked to the actors would talk back, there was ruckus, there was moving around. People weren't sitting in their chairs with their opera glasses clapping with their nice clothes. At least not yet. Now, by 1891, things had changed a bit. A publication called the New York Dramatic Mirror had profiled the Branch Opera House, saying that the elites had gone somewhere else. They were no longer attending the Branch Opera House. One of the places they could have gone was at the performing center called the Casino at the Tampa Bay Hotel. That was an option where the elites could have been going to. But besides this opera house, there were other social gathering places that Tampans enjoyed going.
They had a soda fountain, and they had two ice cream shops, one which was over on that corner, and one which was actually here, and owned by a man with, I think, a very unfortunate name.
Mr. Gross. So you could go down to Mr. Gross's ice cream and hopefully get something good. There were also fun events that the city would put on. They used to project silent films on a building and have people sit in the old courthouse lawn and have a piano accompaniment.
They'd have live bands playing. People gathered in homes all along Franklin Street. For things like debate clubs, literary societies, and even seances, which were very popular in the late 1800s.
And there was also less respectable fun. There were saloons, disorderly houses, which meant brothels, and gambling places along the street that we now call Kennedy. So much so that a young woman who lived in Tampa in the 1800s recorded in her journal.
I remembered often seeing drunk staggering, sitting, or lying on the sidewalk and streets around Tampa saloons. So these disorderly places of entertainment clashed with city leaders and many residents' hopes of a more refined and modern city. And the Tampa Tribune had all kinds of articles about people complaining about this and these ungentlemanly places of entertainment and how the city really needed to do something about them. And they tried, but as things like that do, those businesses continued to flourish. So we are now going to go on to our next stop, which is we're going to talk about the Plant Railroad.
We're standing in a pretty good view of the Tampa Bay Hotel to the wreck. And here we're going to be talking about the history of the railroad and what they did with Tampa. Now, before the railroad came, travel to and from Tampa was extremely difficult. If you look inside your pamphlet, there's a map, and it has some roads drawn on it. They were very difficult to traverse these roads. They were usually made of sand, and it wasn't really appealing to travel so much into Tampa. And it made the people who lived in Tampa feel very isolated. Before the Civil War, Tampans experienced this feeling, which historian Cantor Brown Jr. called railroad fever. Not to be confused with yellow fever, which ravaged the area in the late 1880s. Very different.
They were just feverish for the railroad to come, and very desperate. The civic leaders of Tampa contacted the Florida Railroad Company to try and get them to come to Tampa, and though they kept kind of, flirting with Tampa that maybe they would come, many years passed, and eventually people in Tampa got very frustrated.
And the citizens got so frustrated that what they did is they made an effigy of David Ewing, who was the owner of the railroad and also if you knew your Florida history, he's also a senator.
And they actually burned an effigy of Senator David Dooley, who was the owner of the company. They burned this effigy downtown. So they were really ripped up about the railroad.
They had a great ruckus about it. But David probably couldn't see it because there was no railroad to get here, so he probably wasn't bothered. But they were really angry. After the Civil War, what Henry B. Plant had done was buy up railroads that had been disjointed and broken. And one of the things he did was run that railroad down into Tampa, and everyone loved him for it. And he basically cured their railroad fever. He had nothing to do with the yellow fever, nothing he could do about that. But what this railroad did is it brought in settlers, goods, investors most importantly, and news. It connected Tampa to the wider United States.
So with the addition of Plant's steamship line, which came later, Tampa really became part of the world. And the harbor made it a center for Caribbean and also U.S. commerce. And it also brought Vicente Iver and his business to Tampa, which we know was a great boon for the city. And eventually the military also came to it during the Spanish-American War. Teddy Roosevelt came through with the Rough Riders and embarked from Tampa's ports. So this also put Tampa in the national spotlight as people, you know, were following Roosevelt. They were hearing about Tampa. So on to our second to last stop, which is just another couple blocks away on the corner of Franklin and Back Street.
Here on Franklin Street, what we're going to talk about is business. Because Franklin Street and its imported goods shops and diverse businesses helped Tampa shed its frontier image in favor of more cosmopolitan image, something that looked more sophisticated.
Early trade in Tampa was centered down around Fort Brooke, around Whiting and Washington Streets. But as the city was growing and more and more people were coming in, there were also more and more stores selling more diverse range of products.
Now, if you look inside your pamphlets, on I believe the back page, there is an image of a bunch of advertisements. Now, these advertisements are from the era, and they give you a little idea of what people were buying and what was for sale.
The early stores sold mainly staple goods, but as the city grew, you could find all kinds of products, including books, which were very popular, all kinds of books, Shakespeare, cookbooks, Bibles, children's books, and a number of other things that, one might expect, wine and food, including kegs of spiced pig feet.
Spiced pig feet. But one of the things, and most importantly, that the Franklin Street business area offered them were ready-made clothes. Tampans no longer had to buy, basically, the directions to make their clothes, go home and sell them. They could buy, like we do today, go to these stores and buy shirts and pants and skirts and dresses and things like that. Now, a lot of the most popular stores were located on this road and continued to be located there up until the mid to late 20th century. If you went on our mid-century walk, that will bring back some memories. The Moss Brothers building, which made its final resting stop there, where that parking lot is, started in a different building on this street during the late 1800s. It was very popular, and what it did is it sparked and took part in the birth of consumerism and the ability for people to go to stores and buy nice things.
Another way that consumerism changed during this period was that through U.S. imperial expansion, more and more imported goods were being brought into the country, and they came into even smaller towns and, like Tampa. So, like we talked about, during this period, Tampa was struggling to lose that frontier town image and become more of a modern city. So buying these imported goods that came from around the world really gave them a chance to kind of cultivate a more cosmopolitan image for the city. So people loved it.
Now these consumer goods that Americans were able to buy were seen by them to be somewhat exotic. A lot in the same way if you go to Pier 1 today and buy a lamp and it looks sort of funky and someone asks you like, oh, where's that from? And you say China, even though you got it at Pier 1. That's basically the idea of what's going on here, that people were able to buy these goods from different countries here in Tampa. And it allowed the city to become more cosmopolitan. It gave it a fancier tones, sort of, that he was able to say, like, oh yeah, in Tampa we have nice things too.
In walking along here, you could find just a dazzling array of all kinds of imported products. Chinese and Japanese silks, embroidery, fancy goods, I don't know what those are, teas, and porcelain. You could also find things from Algeria, Persian rugs, things from Turkey, Egyptian brassware, and all sorts of hats and clothing imported from France. And even Mars Brothers sold in imported dress patterns so that women could make, you know, imported fancy European clothes.
There were Cuban shop owners, Scottish, Chinese, Caribbean, Jewish, and African American, many of which owned buildings that, or excuse me, businesses that we recognize today, like the Moss Brothers. And all of these people were living and working on Franklin Street. And there's not a lot of houses on the street now, but back then there were. But they did not live in Hartford. A lot of Tampa newspapers expressed a lot of distrust and dislike of Asian merchants. And at this time, it was also the emergence of the segregated living areas in Tampa between around the Franklin Street and then the Scrub, which is basically around where Central Street is now, started to develop. Though consumerism and these nice goods gave Tampa a new cosmopolitan image, its racial and ethnic issues were a far cry from modern.
There was diversity, but it wasn't all rosy. So we're going to head off to our last stop now, which is Tampa Harness and Wagon Company building, which is a little bit north of Tyler.
Yes, she snuck up with us somewhere.
I did.
In the middle.
Back when you were meeting my mom.
The Tampa Tribune, when it first opened, called it an elegant building. And we actually have a photograph of it right here that we're going to be handing around. And it'll give you an idea of what it looked like at the time. And maybe you can pick out some of its more elegant features. And what this place did is it basically satisfied the growing city's need for transportation. They sold things like bicycles, which was very important for local businesses to get around with small goods, and carriages, which were important for larger items. And it also gave young couples a private space where they could mingle and get to know each other better. A lot like cars today. And this building actually stayed around long enough as the Tampa Harness and Wagon Co. to eventually sell automobiles.
So the store closed in 1915 when the company relocated to another location, but a number of other businesses occupied the space, including the Magnet Drugstore and my favorite, the Tampa Bag Store, which I guess are bags, and the Tampa Home Furniture Company, which was here for 40 years. this corner is also important for another reason. We're standing here in this parking lot. There used to be a store called the Allen Grocery, and this was a popular gathering place for residents and farmers in pioneer Tampa days.
It was roughly here where this parking lot is now. And here, Tampans, both from inside the city and in rural areas, would come to converge, socially talk, buy the things that they needed. But this didn't last for too long. See, before the Civil War, Tampa was very much still a frontier city, which means it was sort of on the edge of what would be considered civilization. The rules, social etiquettes, and cultural mores that were normal in the rest of the nation didn't really happen here. So at the store, at the Allen Grocery, you'd have enslaved people, you'd have free African Americans, white people who owned or didn't own slaves, all coming to this one place and socializing. But after the trains came and the frontier image sort of dissolved and more of these cultural and social rules came to Tampa, that stopped completely.
And this meant that they began to enforce racial segregation. So by the time the Spanish-American War in 1898, when the troops were coming through, we had the white soldiers, but also the African-American Buffalo soldiers, and Tampa's racial segregation inflamed tensions between them, and there were riots that resulted.
And all of these racial and social things started coming into play in Tampa, and this was no longer a space of unity. And this building, and the one that used to be here, this parking lot, gives us a little glimpse into the city's past, and it reminds us that Tampa did have a very vibrant social environment beyond its very suburban and mainly parking lot present.
The Tampa Wagon and Harness Building was almost demolished in 2006, which is the same year that the Moss Brothers Building was lost. And they were going to also, same plan, create condominiums. There was talk a few years ago of rehabbing it and creating a nightclub, but as you can see, nothing came of that, and it is very long neglected and in disrepair. And I hope, because I love the Wagon Building, and it is one of our last remaining, you know, traces of the 1800s that exist physically in Tampa, or in downtown at least, I'm hopeful that something can be done with it. So this is actually our last stop. Today we've looked at some of the places the Tampans would gather downtown in the early days. We hope we'll have a deeper understanding of these places and maybe a connection to them and maybe to some of their stories. Though many of the earliest buildings are gone, what we do have is the original street layout.
We are basically living on the same city outline that they did back then. The roads that we drive on, although paved, are the same roads that early Tampans used to get to and from their works and home.
And most of the street names are actually the same too, with the exception of Florida and Kennedy. So we still drive our cars. We're 19th century Tampans, drove the horse-drawn carriages, and we walk the same streets that people over 150 years ago were also walking.
So what we hope that we've done for you today and throughout the rest of our walks that the History Department, the Do the Locomotion, and the Tampa Downtown Partnership has done for you is giving you new eyes in which to see the city.
Everywhere you go in Tampa, in downtown, you're really hearing echoes from the past of all those people who struggled to make this a thriving city, and our hope is that today we've made those echoes a little bit easier to hear.
So now you are not only in Tampa 2013, but you have an appreciation and understanding of the Tampa of before. And we thank you so much for coming on our walk today.
So thank you for coming to our final walk. PSF History Department grad students, we really, really enjoyed this. It's been a great experience. We really loved working with the partnership. They're wonderful. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.